Well, good morning and welcome to the Breakfast News on Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Aishwarya Kapoor. Let us start the news bulletin with the headlines. President Ramnath Kovind signs ordinance banning practice of instant triple talaq. Union Cabinet had approved ordinance on a Wednesday, making it a punishable offence. Scheme to pay cash relief to insured persons during unemployment during period announced. Atal Bimal Vyakti Kalyan Yojana to give relief in cash directly to the bank account while individual searches for a new job. Vice President invites a Romanian businessman to partner with India in its exciting and transformative journey. Bucharest Chamber of Commerce signs three MOUs with the leading Indian Chambers of Commerce for greater cooperation in trade and investment. M. Venkaiah Naidu to conclude his three-nation Europe visit today. Pakistani Prime Minister Imran Khan seeks a resumption of talks in a letter to Prime Minister Modi, proposes a foreign minister-level talks in New York on the sidelines of UN General Assembly later this month. And India beat Pakistan by 8 wickets at the Asia Cup match in Dubai on Wednesday. Men in blue chased down target of 163 runs with 21 overs to spare. Bangladesh to take on Afghanistan in today's encounter. President Ramnath Kovind has signed the ordinance banning the practice of instant triple talaq. The president's signature has come after the union minister on Wednesday approved the triple talaq ordinance, making the practice a penal offence. The ordinance was made necessary after the amended draft bill failed to clear Rajya Sabha in the last session of parliament amid a disagreement within parties. And Law Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad appealed to the opposition parties to rise above vote bank politics and support the bill.
Cabinet on Wednesday approved an ordinance to ban the practice of instant triple talaq, making it a penal offence. After the Union Cabinet meeting, Law Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad said there was a compelling necessity to bring an ordinance as instances of talaq-e-biddat continue unabated despite the Supreme Court striking it down and Lok Sabha having passed the Muslim Women Protection of Rights on Marriage Bill. The bill is awaiting passage in Rajya Sabha. The minister informed that instant triple talaq cases reported between the period of January 2017 to September 13, 2018 were 430.
There was a compelling necessity to come with an ordinance. There was an overpowering urgency to come with an ordinance. Duniya ke 22 Islamic mulkon mein 3 talaq ko niyantrit kiya gaya hai. Lekin Bharat aise secular mulk mein बड़ी संख्या में हमारी खवातीन बेटियों बहनों के साथ नाइंसाफी हो रही थी.
Under the proposed ordinance, giving instant triple talaq will be illegal and void and will attract a jail term of 3 years for the husband. Under the ordinance, the crime will be recognized only when the woman herself or her blood relative files a complaint against the husband. The case may be dropped if the duo reaches a compromise, but only if the wife approaches the magistrate. The magistrate can grant the accused bail on reasonable grounds, but only after hearing the wife. The wife will be given custody of the child and is entitled to maintenance decided by the magistrate for herself and her children.
Sonia ji, ye adhyadesh desh hit mein laya gaya. सोनिया जी यह अध्यादेश देश की नारी के इंसाफ के लिए लाया गया है मैं आपसे अपील करूंगा कि वोट बैंक की चारदीवारी से ऊपर उठकर इंसानियत और इंसाफ के लिए आपका समर्थन हो
The opposition took a dig at the government and called the move pre-election politics.
अगर व्यक्ति जेल चला जाएगा तो उस गरीब असहाय मुस्लिम महिला को भत्ता कौन देगा उसके बच्चों का खर्चा कौन देगा उसकी रोजी रोटी चलाने का खर्चा कौन देगा इसलिए कानून में इस संशोधन को हमने सुझाया था पर मोदी सरकार इसे राजनीतिक फुटबॉल अधिक और मुस्लिम महिलाओं के साथ न्याय का मामला कम बनाना चाहती है
The bill to criminalize talaq-e-biddat was passed by the Lok Sabha in the winter session of the parliament last year, but got stuck in Rajya Sabha with opposition parties raising reservations over the criminal provisions in the draft law. As per the Muslim Women Protection of Rights on Marriage Bill 2017, triple talaq in any form, spoken, written or by electronic means such as email, SMS and instant messengers are declared illegal and void with a punishment of up to 3 years in jail for the husband. Panchanan Mishra's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
And the Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs on Wednesday approved the revised cost estimate of a project to improve the safety of 198 dams across the country. The revised cost has now been pegged at 3,466 crore rupees. Originally, the total cost of the project was 2,100 crore rupees, with a state component of 1,968 crore rupees and the central component of 132 crore rupees. The scheme envisages comprehensive rehabilitation of 198 existing dam projects located in Kerala, Madhya Pradesh, Odisha, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Jharkhand and Uttarakhand. The project will improve the safety and operational performance of selected existing dams and mitigate risks to ensure safety of downstream population and property. The CCEA, headed by Prime Minister Modi, also approved an increase in the honorarium for the Anganwadi and Asha workers effective from next month. Anganwadi workers receiving 3,000 rupees per month will now get 4,500 rupees. Similarly, those at mini Anganwadi centres receiving 2,200 rupees per month will now get 3,500 rupees per month. The honorarium for Anganwadi helpers has also been increased from 1,500 rupees to 2,250 rupees per month. The Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs, chaired by Prime Minister Narendra Modi, has also given its approval to increase routine and recurring incentives under the National Health Mission for ASHA workers from 1,000 rupees to 2,000 rupees per month.
Anganwadi workers ka pehle honorarium tha 3,000 rupees per mahina. Ab ye badhkar ho gaya 4,500 per mahina. To pure 1,500 rupees ki badhat hui hai. और आंगनवाड़ी वर्कर जो है, जिसको हम मिनी आंगनवाड़ी सेंटर भी कहते हैं, वो पहले 2,250 मिलता था उनको, अब वो बढ़कर 3,500 हो गया है. और जो आंगनवाड़ी हेल्पर हैं, जिनको सिर्फ 1,500 मिलता था, उनको भी 2,250 मिलेगा.
On to some other news, employees State Insurance Corporation on Wednesday approved a new scheme called as Atal Bimit Vyakti Kalyan Yojana, which would pay cash relief to insured persons during the period of unemployment. The proposal scheme was approved in the ESIC board meeting that was chaired by Labour Minister Santosh Kumar Gangwar in the national capital. The scheme is a relief payable in cash directly to the bank account of the insured person in case of unemployment and while they search for new engagement. The scheme would benefit insured persons that who are covered under the Employees State Insurance Act of 1948. The ESIC also approved the proposal for relaxing eligibility conditions for availing a super speciality treatment from earlier insurable employment of 2 years to 6 months with contribution requirement of only 78 days. It has approved the proposal for increasing the funeral expenses from the existing 10,000 rupees to 15,000 rupees being paid in the death of the insured person. And on to news on the Vice President's Europe visit. And M. Venkaiah Naidu has invited Romanian businessmen to partner with India in its exciting and transformative journey. He said this while addressing the India-Romania Business Forum after holding bilateral meetings with the President, Prime Minister and interacting with the Presidents of both Houses of Parliament. The Vice President said that India-Romania annual bilateral trade has risen to $810 million in 2017-18, a 40% increase over last year when it was $575 million. He termed it a huge development in bilateral economic relations and said that there is a need to sustain the momentum. He said that India's economic transformation in the recent past presents a fresh opportunity in multiple sectors for Romanian entrepreneurs. The Bucharest Chamber of Commerce of Romania signed 3 MOUs with the leading Indian Chambers of Commerce, CII, ASSOCHAM and PHDCCI to pave the way for greater and better exchange of information and cooperation in trade and investment sectors.
India has opened up. Foreign direct investment is totally allowed in almost all the major sectors. And then public-private partnership is the way forward, allowing the private sector to participate in a big way. The third one is special purpose vehicle for each of the projects, important projects, is another initiative. The Prime Minister of the country is a reformer. He gave a 3-line advice to the entire country. He said reform, perform and transform. Transformation of the nation, that is his ambition. That is his mission. And he is doing it with all conviction and perfection. That the opportunities that are available in India. Some of you have already have experience, but you will, your experience in the coming days will be better because we have learned by experience. We have also followed the best practices followed by others. And then this ease of doing business and also giving priority to the approvals, that is going to make all the difference.
And earlier, Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu held a delegation-level talks with the Prime Minister of Romania, Varisa Danicla, on Wednesday and said that the economics of India and Romania are complementing each other. Vice President Naidu said that a planned cooperation can lead to faster growth. The talks focused on strengthening trade and investment in sectors like ICT, pharmaceuticals, manufacturing, infrastructure, logistics, agri-foods and tourism. The MOU on tourism was signed between the two countries to improve tourism on both sides and indirectly increase people-to-people connect. Matters like enabling easy air travel access, hassle-free facilitation of visas to promote people-to-people contact and business were also discussed during the delegation-level meet.
Our cooperation can lead to faster growth of our economies further. We intend to deepen and diversify economic and technological cooperation between our countries. India-Romanian annual bilateral trade has risen to US$810 million in 2017-18, a 40% increase over the last year.
And Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu also conveyed India's perspective on international terrorism, climate change and other global issues during delegation-level talks with the President of Romania on Wednesday. And during his interaction, Vice President Naidu stressed the need to have strong people-to-people links and he called them pillars in bilateral relationship.
On the first day of his visit to Romania, Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu called on the country's president and discussed crucial matters including trade, economy, international terrorism and climate change, among other global issues.
The morning's talks with the Honorable President and his delegation were very meaningful and very productive. We acknowledge the long-standing excellent relation between India and Romania, reviewed bilateral and multilateral cooperation, and reaffirmed the mutual desire to comprehensively strengthen our partnership across the political, economic, science and technology, culture and people-to-people domain. We focused on strengthening our trade and investment.
After the meet, the Vice President said that ease of mobility is a strong parameter for assessing the depth of any bilateral relationship. He further added that India will encourage Romanian nationals to use the e-visa facility.
I convey best wishes for the upcoming presidency of Council of European Union in January 2019. Romania has emerged as a respected leader in the Balkans. We appreciate Romania's spirit to succeed and have faith in its efforts for a better tomorrow. I am glad that we agreed that we shall work towards enhancing already excellent trade relations. I am also glad that Petroleum University of Forisia, Romania and Pandit Dindal Upadhyaya Petroleum University, Gandhinagar, Gujarat, signing an MOU for capacity building and mutual trade, we have to create the needed atmosphere and global consensus to fight terrorism, which is a menace for the humanity.
Both countries aim to boost economic, commercial and cultural relations with this high-level meet. The last high-level visit to Romania from India was in 2005, when the then Vice President Bhairav Singh Shekhawat visited the country.
The Vice President of India and the President of Romania held delegation-level bilateral talks in the Romanian Presidential Palace today. Both the leaders discussed matters relating to tour, trade and agriculture. Both the leaders recognize that terror is the enemy of the world and have decided to scourge all form of terror. With camera person Raj Thakur from Romanian Presidential Palace, Rajkamal Rao, Rajya Sabha TV.
On to some other news now. Prime Minister Narendra Modi will lay the foundation stone of India International Convention and Expo Centre in New Delhi today. Now, releasing a statement, a Commerce Ministry said that the facilities provided at the centre will be on par with the best in the world in size and in quality, offering a settling of international and national events, meetings, conferences, exhibitions and trade shows. The project is planned over an area of 221.37 acres in Dwarka at an estimated cost of 25,703 crore rupees. IICC will be an integrated complex with facilities like exhibition halls, convention center, open exhibition spaces and retail services and high-end offices. The convention center will be developed in two phases. Phase 1 and Phase 2 will be completed by December 2019 and December 2024, respectively. In breakfast news, time for a very short break here. We'll be back with more news.
Tales that inspire. Stories of social change. A salute to diversity. Promoting public discourse. Events that motivate. Inspiring the innovative spirit. Watch Rajya Sabha television documentaries.
Welcome back after the break. Pakistani Prime Minister Imran Khan has written to Prime Minister Narendra Modi seeking resumption of dialogue between the two countries. Now, Khan has sought a meeting between Foreign Ministers Sushma Swaraj and Shah Mahmood Qureshi on the sidelines of the UN General Assembly in New York later this month. Now, Khan's letter was in response to Prime Minister Modi's own communication to him seeking a meaningful and constructive engagement between the two countries. Let's get a perspective on the story. We have with us our colleague Akhilesh Suman joining us on the phone line. Akhilesh, a few days back, Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan in a statement had said that, you know, putting Kashmir first is important for Indo-Pak talks. But with this letter, a new hope really has been given for Indo-Pak talks resumption. What can we expect?
Talks will take place between Sushma Swaraj and Pakistan's foreign minister. But what we are getting from highly placed sources that yes, engagement is there. And there are consultations on this issue. And you know that India has always said that once terrorism stops, India will be willing to go into comprehensive talks. So given this fact that, you know, that situation on the LOC is continuously being monitored, that how Pakistani army is firing at the border, and also the question of infiltration is still going on. And given the, also the fact that there has been an incident yesterday that BSF Jawan has been killed, and then a question of reports of his mutilation is also coming. So India is always evaluating the whole situation. And when Sushma Swaraj will be going on his visit to America next week, I think next week on 29th, she has to speak to the UN General Assembly. Before that, there may be a meeting of SAARC foreign ministers that is fixed almost, because it takes place every year. And other than SAARC foreign ministers' visit, there are willingness from Pakistani side, and that is why Imran Khan has written a letter to Prime Minister Narendra Modi about the talks. So, you know, that India has always been very guarded in expressing the emotions now, because we had a very bitter experience about Pakistan's, that double speak, because the civilian government speaks in some other words, and the army and the terrorist, army-sponsored terrorists work in some other way. So it is really interesting that how situations emerge, because 1 week is still there, and after 1 week, what situations emerge, it is going to be seen very closely, and we will be getting some sort of input continuously on that, Aishwarya.
Right. Thank you so much, Akhilesh, for that perspective on that story. Thank you so much. And the U.S. has said that Jaish-e-Mohammed and Lashkar-e-Toyba terrorist groups continue to pose a regional threat in the subcontinent, and that Pakistan did not adequately address America's concern on terrorism in 2017. In its annual country report on terrorism for the year 2017, the U.S. State Department said that although Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan and Pakistan has been seriously degraded, remnants of its global leadership as well as its regional affiliate Al-Qaeda in the Indian subcontinent continue to operate from remote locations in the region. The report noted that despite Donald Trump administration placing a pause on spending new foreign military financing for Pakistan from August to December 2017, Pakistan did not adequately address U.S. concerns, and that several terrorist groups focused on attacks outside the country continued to operate from the Pakistani soil in 2017. The report also said that almost 59% of all the terrorist attacks in 2017 took place in five Asian countries, including India and Pakistan. It further said that the total number of terrorist attacks worldwide last year decreased by 23%. News from Malaysia now, where the country's former Prime Minister Najib Razak was arrested on Wednesday over graft allegations. Malaysia's anti-corruption agency said that Najib Razak was arrested at his office on Wednesday late afternoon, and he will be taken to a court today to face charges. The agency alleges that hundreds of millions of dollars linked to a state investment fund ended up in his personal bank account. It is noteworthy that Najib Razak has already been slapped with 7 charges, 3 for criminal breach of trust, 3 for money laundering, and 1 for abuse of power in another graft case. He has pleaded not guilty to all the charges and has consistently denied wrongdoing. And U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo says that he is ready to restart negotiations with Pyongyang with the aim of denuclearizing North Korea by 2021. The U.S. reaction comes after South Korean President Moon Jae-in wrapped up his 2-day trip to North Korea. And following talks with President Moon, Kim Jong-un agreed to shut one of the country's main missile testing and launch sites if the United States agrees to corresponding measures. He also agreed on a way to achieve denuclearization. Pompeo said that it was on the basis of North's commitments that the U.S. was prepared to engage immediately in negotiations. U.S. President Donald Trump also struck an optimistic tone while speaking to reporters in the White House, saying that the summit between leader Kim Jong-un and South Korean President Moon Jae-in boded well for peace. It is noteworthy that discussions between North Korea and the U.S. had stalled following a broad strokes agreement that was made earlier this year. But meeting between Kim Jong-un and the South Korean president seems to have reassured Washington. On to all the sporting action now. First up, cricket. India defeated arch rivals Pakistan by 8 wickets in the ongoing Asia Cup at the Dubai International Stadium yesterday. Chasing a target of 163 runs, the men in blue comfortably clinched the victory with 21 overs to spare. Opener Shikhar Dhawan and skipper Rohit Sharma gave a solid start to the Indian side. Sharma scored 52 runs while Dhawan contributed 46. And after the departure of the openers, Ambati Raidu and Dinesh Karthik steered India to victory. Earlier, batting first, the Pakistani side was bundled out for just 162 runs in 43.1 overs. Babar Azam was the highest scorer for the Pakistani side with his knock of 47. For India, Kedar Jadhav and Bhuvneshwar Kumar picked up 3 wickets each, while Jasprit Bumrah took 2 wickets. And in today's match, Bangladesh will take on Afghanistan. While this will be the first match for Bangladesh in the Asia Cup, Afghanistan has already defeated Sri Lanka in its previous game. And Indian women's team defeated Sri Lanka by 13 runs in the first T20 international of the 5-match series in Sri Lanka yesterday, chasing a target of 169 runs. The Lankan side were bundled out for 155 runs in 19.3 overs. For India, skipper Harmanpreet Kaur was the pick of the bowlers as she took 4 wickets. Batting first, the Indian side posted 168 runs on the board for the loss of 8 wickets in their allotted 20 overs. Jay Rogriggs smashed 36 off 15 balls and struck 3 sixes in an over to become the first Indian woman to do so. While Tanya Bhatia was the highest scorer for India with her knock of 46 runs. And the second T20 will be played in Colombo on Friday. News from the world of badminton now. Ace Indian shuttler Kidambi Srikant entered the pre-quarter finals of the men's singles in the China Open badminton tournament. Srikant defeated Denmark's Rasmus Gemke 21-9, 21-19 to set up a clash against the opponent from Thailand. While in another match, H.S. Pranoy bowed out of the tournament after losing his match against Hong Kong's Nung Kha Ko Long 21-16, 21-11. In the women's singles, P.V. Sindhu will take on Busnan of Thailand today, while mixed doubles team of Sathvik Sairaj Ranki Reddy and Ashwini Ponappa will today take on a Chinese duo of Zheng Suiwei and Huang Xia Zhong today. And earlier, the duo registered a win over Marcus Ellis and Lauren Smith in the first round. And with that, we wrap up this edition of Breakfast News. Thanks for watching.